know like what the direct translation is.
Right.
It's a teaching given by the Buddha.
Okay, a teaching given by the Buddha. Fair enough. Okay, good. And what other questions can I ask? So is there anyone who's never heard of the sutta before? What about, I'll just test you out a few things that I might be using today. What about Pali? Have you ever heard the word Pali?
Mm-hmm.
What's Pali?
It's the language that the suttas was written in.
Fair enough, yeah? Fair enough. Excellent. So, this is pretty good already. Maybe we just finish up, don't we? my work here is done. Okay. No, we're doing pretty good. And one of the things that find in Buddhist tradition is that strangely and for probably historically complicated reasons that often a lot of people who are Buddhist or who like to practice Buddhism or are interested in it often don't really know what suttas say or don't even know that they exist. And so a lot of people will just sort of listen to what, you know, the Dhamma teacher tells them or something like that. And that's okay, that's fine, right? As long as they're telling you, you know, they're telling you it's okay. But seems to be kind of missing out, right? Because we actually have the teachings of the Buddha. Good evening, welcome, you're just in time. Thank you so much. Please come, there's space at the front if you have to sit on the floor. If not,
you can move the cushion.
You can move to the side.
So, don't worry, you haven't missed anything important. I'm just blathering on for a few minutes while people settle down. Okay, so we're good. Now, so the idea in the suttas is that we can get access to something which is as close as possible to what the Buddha himself taught. Now I'm going to be discussing some of the issues and so on about that, but this is the basic idea behind it. And I think it's really important that we do that we need to make sure that we don't fall into a trap of being like getting all fundamentalist about it, right? So the fact that somebody doing something different from the suttas that they're kind of wrong and bad and you can be annihilated. Okay, so it's not kind of like that. But it's that the suttas provide us with some wisdom which can help us in our path, that's all. And if that's helpful for us, then that's really good. So, good evening, Kara. How are you doing?
I'm good. Sorry for being late.
You do not have to be sorry. You came at exactly the right time. You came neither too early nor too late, but exactly when you arrived. So, okay. Now, okay, so good. So, one last question. In the suttas, did the Buddha teach about mindfulness? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes, you see, these guys don't know me yet. So Buddha was teaching in Pali. He talked about sati.
Mm-hmm.
Right, trick question. Gotcha. So, mindfulness is a modern English translation. Bear this in mind, that when we, you know, read the suttas or gain access to Buddha's teaching, we see them through a lens. We see them through a lens of translation, we see them through the lens of time, culture, assumptions, all of these kinds of things that separate us from what Buddha was saying. And the remarkable thing is not that that exists, the remarkable thing is that somehow the teachings come through anyway. That's the thing that's really amazing about suttas. Now, one of the common teachings found commonly in the suttas is that a practice. practice, or a description of the path of practice for lay people specifically, is a threefold practice. Dana is generosity, sila is keeping precepts, and bhavana is meditation. Okay? So we are now, with your permission, going to practice the first one of those things, which is dana. Are you all happy to do this together? You're all happy to do this? Okay, so what you're going to do in just a minute, you're going to get up, you're going to go to the other side of the room, you're going to say hello to someone who you don't know, and you're going to give them something that you have. Something that's in your pocket, or something that you have, some possession that you have right now. Alright? You're going to give it away, and they're going to give you something. And this is for realsies, alright? No, so if you give away your car keys, then that's it. Anyway, if you don't have anything to give, that's fine. You can say hello. But if you can find something to give, that's good. So go and find somebody you don't know, introduce yourself, and give them something. It's a very hard one to master.
Hello.
Hi.
That we can realize and implement right away. Another really important teaching that the Buddha taught in the suttas is what we call in Pali, Kalyanamittata, or good friendship. And I know that often in Buddhism, you know, we have this kind of idea, this kind of, you just sort of sit there and close your eyes and, I don't know, just go into some spacey dimension of beyond time and space or something like that. But the Buddha really emphasized spiritual friendship. He said it's the whole of spiritual practice, is spiritual friendship. Right? And this is what we have here. Right? We have a group of people. We actually join together and supporting each other in practice. So please don't think of each other as just like randos that have to be sitting next to you in the dumb hall, right? Right? These are your spiritual friends. And look out for each other, help each other, yeah? Take care of each other. And, you know, how are we going over there? Someone sit? Someone's trying to come in.
You're still pushing on the pull bar.
just like samsara. I feel like it's been me and Nibbana for years. Just in time. Excellent. You missed out on all the boring stuff. Give up the good bits now. Okay, so where was I? Oh yes. So for this evening, I want to say a few words about these suttas and to hopefully explain a little bit more about what we talk about, you know, what we talk about when we talk about the suttas. Explain a bit more about what kinds of things that we might hope to find there and what kinds of help we might hope to find, but also what kinds of things we might not hope to find. And I would like to encourage all of you to consider making reading the suttas like a part of your spiritual practice. Suttas a little bit every day is good, even once a week or something is good, forming a sort of reading group or something is good. And don't think of it as being something that you have to master or, you know, be an expert at. Think of it as choosing to spend some time with a good friend. I spent 2.5 years on a little island in off the coast of Taiwan translating suttas every day. And to me that was just time spent with my best friend. And every day just reading what the Buddha was saying and trying to figure out what it was all about, trying to express that. So, okay, now I'm going to begin the more sort of sensible part of the evening now. I think most people probably will come in. But just before we do that, I want to begin by introducing a practice which we do commonly in Australia. And in Australia it's conventional that before any event of significance that you acknowledge the indigenous owners of the land who are there before you. So I'd like to do that and to acknowledge the Native American peoples who owned this land and looked after this land for thousands of years and who took care of the water, who took care of the animals, and who, whose spirit kept this land for thousands of years. I would like to pay respects to the elders of past, present, and future. Okay. Excellent. Welcome. Just in time. There's no right time to go. There's plenty of space up the front. Yeah. You can do the walk of shame. Welcome. Just in time. The table room at the front, if you wanted to sit at the back. No? You're happy at the back? Isn't that come? You can sit on the floor or you can bring the chair up the front. Excellent. just in time. We've just done all the boring bits, all right? So we'll get back here in a little bit. Just a little bit about people who kind of know what the suttas are and these kinds of things. Now, again, not meaning to guilt anybody or anything, but how many people here read suttas on an occasion or have ever read suttas on an occasion? Oh, really? Lots of people. Excellent. Oh, that's good. Okay, so we have a starting point. Oh, that's good. Since you already know a little bit about this and so on, what I might do is just speak fairly briefly and then open it up to questions, because I'm guessing you might have some questions about it. But I might just talk a little bit about what the suttas say and do not say about meditation to begin with, and then we can do some meditation together. Would you like to do that?
Mm-hmm.
Would you like to do some meditation?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, excellent. Anyone who doesn't want to do any meditation, that's fine. Just sit there and do nothing. All right, so meditation. Right. Now, in the suttas, there are many words used to talk about meditation, but one of the terms, which I just mentioned a little bit earlier, Dharma Sina Bhavana, is the word Bhavana. And the word Bhavana doesn't strictly mean meditation per se. It literally means development or growth, something like that. Making something be more. Right? So for meditation, you say Chitta Bhavana. It means making the mind be more. Right? In other words, growing your mind, enhancing your mind, expanding your mind. That's really what the essence of meditation is about. And so, because meditation these days is quite a common concept, it's worth reflecting on how rapidly this has changed and how this actually didn't really used to be the case at all. For a long time, the mind was thought of as something that was more or less like a kind of like a screen or a tablet that you could write on, right? So it's just a kind of, the mind was something that was given, and you could sort of put things into it, but you didn't really change what the mind was. And that idea was reflected even in neuroscience until fairly recently, and they kind of basically believed that adult brains were more or less static. And it's only in the last couple of decades that they started talking about neuroplasticity and so on. So this idea that the Buddha had, obviously not restricted to the Buddha, but was central to the Buddha's program, was that the mind wasn't something that just is, right? It's not something that's just given. And this, I mean, this is something we still have today. Like you have, you know, for example, you have concepts today, like say a person has an IQ of such and such, right? I mean, what a ridiculous concept. Yeah, your person's IQ or intelligence is not something that's fixed and static. I mean, for any given person, it changes completely during the day. So the mind is not something that's fixed, it's something that's conditioned. Right? That's the important thing. The mind is conditioned. It's conditioned by good things, and it's conditioned by bad things. If you condition your mind one way, it will end up that way. If you condition it the other way, it will end up the other way. And so what we can't do is just say to our minds, be enlightened. Right? You can't just make it do something, but you can train it. So this idea of training the mind. How do you train the mind? Well, basically the same as any other kind of training, by more or less doing the same thing again and again until you get better a little bit by a little bit. So these kinds of ideas like development, growth, training, these are intrinsic to the way that the Buddha talked about the mind and about spiritual development. And so it's always really striking when you hear these kinds of things, this kind of language is right throughout the suttas, like all the time. And as compared to a lot of religious dialogue, which is about like being saved or these kinds of things, And it's about what you do, what you choose to do. So you choose to use your mind in a certain way, you will have certain results. Sikha, Eka, Sanya, Vajanti. Through training, certain kinds of perceptions arise. Through training, certain kinds of perceptions cease. So we can decide to use our mind in a certain way, and then that grows our mind. Now, the tricky bit is that the mind, of course, is complicated, and it's got good stuff and bad stuff inside of it. So you can train the bad stuff in your mind just as much as you train the good stuff. And just because you're meditating doesn't necessarily mean that you're somehow free from that. Right? As long as we still have delusion, we're still going to be tricking ourselves about what's going on in the mind. And so it really helps to pay a lot of careful attention to what the Buddha was talking about in meditation. And one of the things that I've learned after meditating for many years and after studying the suttas for many years is I kind of gradually came to realize something which in retrospect is really obvious, which it took me a long time to figure it out. And that is that the way we talk about meditation today is quite different from how the Buddha talked about meditation in the suttas. What I mean is that the language and the concepts and the ideas we use to talk about meditation are quite different. And though that language and those ideas shape our attention, they shape what we do, they shape how we train ourselves. And by shaping how we train ourselves, they shape how do our minds grow. How do we do citta bhava? It has real effects. It's not just a nominal difference, it has real effects in people's minds. So what do I mean by that? Well, tell me if this sounds familiar. And so it's not about any particular meditation teacher or anything like that. It's something that I've heard so many times across so many different people have talked to me about it in the same way. So something like this. Let's say you want to meditate. Okay? How many people here meditate on their breath? Do breath meditation. Okay, fair enough. So let's assume you're doing breath meditation. You could be doing one of the others, but let's say you're doing breath meditation. The first thing you want to do is to try to concentrate on your breath. Right? Is that right? Yeah? How's that working out for you? Sometimes maybe, sometimes not. So you try to concentrate on your breath, right? Then when you try to concentrate on your breath, then mind sort of seems to want to go everywhere else, right? So you take the breath as your meditation object. Is that right? Is that how you think about meditation? Is that always my meditation object? And then all of these, the hassle is that all of these thoughts keep coming in. Right? Sitting trying to meditate, I'm going to try and pay attention to this object, and all of these thoughts keep coming in and annoying me, right? Am I right? And does anybody not recognize that description of meditation? Is that like completely alien to anyone? Okay, we've all been there. And so I'm here trying to meditate, this object of meditation, these thoughts coming kind of in, and well, we do our best, right? Yeah? So what if I was to tell you that if you look closely at how the suttas talk about meditation, they don't use any of those basic concepts or ideas at all. Not at all. They approach meditation and talk about meditation in a completely different way. What would you say?
What is that?
What's the secret? Okay, so the first thing, there's no word for object in the suttas. Full stop. Okay, so there's no word for meditation object or an object of the mind. This is something you hear all the time in modern, especially Theravada Buddhism, they're always talking about objects of the mind. This is a language that's derived from the Abhidhamma, which came after the suttas. Okay, in the suttas, they never talk about object. Interesting, right? Makes a big difference when you think about it, because the notion of an object, the more that you think about it, the more problematic it is. Because when something is an object, it means it exists objectively. I mean, what else could it mean, right? The object is there. It has its own thing. This is definitely what object means in the Abhidhamma. and you have this idea of trying to concentrate on the object. And again, the Buddha didn't use this kind of language when talking about meditation. Once you have the object, then you've said the object is out here and I'm kind of in here. Right? See what you're doing? You use it, when you use language, you think about meditation in that way. You create your experience, which is that I'm somehow separate from my object. Right? But you've created that experience. Which raises the question, if the breath is out here, and I'm in here, watching the breath, who am I? Who's the one in here that's watching the breath? Come on, you're supposed to know these things, aren't you? You're supposed to know these things. Who's the one who's watching the breath? For once, not a trick question. I'm the one here watching the breath, but who is this I? Well, but think about how it goes, and think about how it is psychologically, right? All these thoughts keep coming in. Remember, I said that before, all these thoughts keep coming in. But of course, again, just think about it. Where are those thoughts coming from? Are they like being beamed from a spaceship up in the sky? No? Is it like the government beaming it into your brain? No? I don't think so, right? I mean, it doesn't seem like a completely implausible hypothesis at this point in time. But you could test that by just like putting a tinfoil hat on and feel yourself, right? Thoughts are coming from inside you, actually. They're your thoughts. They're not thoughts that happen to you. They're thoughts that you think. They're thoughts that you do. And because you do them, you're to blame for them. No bloody going off blaming anybody else for them. It's your thoughts. Right? So then think about how the psychology of this is working. I'm in here meditating. My object is out there. I've split my object out. And then all these thoughts are happening. But the thoughts are kind of bad because I don't want them to be there. They're kind of stressful and I don't like them and I don't want to be. So part of myself I have now cut off and shoved outside of myself, and I don't like that. I don't like these bits of myself because they're nasty. So I'm in here, I'm the pure and good one. I'm the meditator. I'm the one who's sitting here, I am so peaceful. I'm so nice. I'm such a nice person. I wouldn't have thoughts like that. Right? I would have lots of metta.
I asked the other day, but does anyone know there was a video by Arj Barker a number of years ago called the Sickest Buddhist? It should be still on YouTube, I think. But it was an excellent analysis of this kind of thing. He says, I don't know how or why, I'm just so Zen, I make the power of now look like the power of then. So this is the thing, this is that ego that we get when we're meditating, because we've created this pure idea of self as in here that's meditating, and it must be separate from all these impure thoughts, right? And it's complicated, right? It's such a mess. No wonder meditation's so hard, because we've created all this mess. We create this mess because of how we approach our meditation. We bring all of these assumptions into it. So, what did the Buddha say? How did the Buddha, when we read the suttas, what does it say about doing breath meditation? So sato vasasati, sato vasasati. Mindful, one breathes in. Mindful, one breathes out. And that's just the start of the teaching on breath meditation. There's a lot more to it than that. But just stay with that bit for a while. Because sometimes when we're reading the suttas, we gloss over things, right? We take it for granted. Like, of course you're breathing mindfully, right? Tell me something I didn't know, Buddha. Right? But we're not really listening to what it's saying. Right? Where does it say you sit down and you try to concentrate on your breath? Where does it say you sit down and you focus on the object of meditation? where does it say are you trying to keep out all the thoughts that are coming in? It doesn't say all those things. What it says is breathe mindfully. Breathe mindfully. It's interesting, right? So this is actually pointing us to not just an interpretation of a passage, but it's pointing us to a different sensibility in how we're approaching meditation. Right? Just think about how that phrase feels, right? To breathe mindfully, rather than to try to concentrate on the breath. Right? Can you see the difference in the feel it has? To breathe mindfully. The breathing is what we do anyway. Right? It's easy. You've been doing it your whole life, yeah? The breathing. So we just bring that quality.